Hi, it's John Coghlan here. You're listening to CATtales.
You're listening to CATtales.
Hi, I'm Cat, and you're listening to CATtales. Before becoming one of the biggest names in rock history, Status Quo honed their craft as a holiday camp act at Butlins in Minehead. 60 years later, the same venue was chosen to host the last performance of John Coghlan's Quo's farewell tour. But John is not ready to hang up his drumsticks for good just yet. Well, as he explains, he hasn't got a dog after all. So what does a man with a successful career behind him do? Well, make more music, of course. This is the other one with John Coghlan. I just saw this on Facebook, because obviously I do follow you, and then I saw this bit about your retirement and I thought, nah, that's not John, because when we last spoke you were like, it's in my blood, I can never retire, you know. And then I saw that you were doing your farewell tour and I thought, he's got something else up his sleeve. So I thought, let's have a chat and find out what it is. And I'm not surprised to hear it's something around jazz. What are you going to be doing then?
Retiring is, you know, you retire and you walk the dog twice a day, and I don't have a dog, so I can't, you know. So really I'm doing this jazz thing. I tell you how it started. It's basically to do with Julie and me going to watch jazz in the Warwick Hall in Burford, which is really close to me in Oxfordshire. So, and I got talking to Paul Jeffries, the double bass player, and he suggested we do something together. So it's just basically John Coghlan's Quo reimagined. And the reimagined is a jazz phrase where they say, you know, it's like someone doing, maybe, I don't know, it's like Shirley Bassey songs, but doing it in a different arrangement, you know, doing it in a jazz feel instead of as the original. So not that we're going to do any Shirley Bassey numbers, but do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, that's the essence of jazz, though, isn't it? That sort of, like, free form and just sort of feel the music and really express it at that moment in time, isn't it?
Yeah, because I think we're obviously going to rehearse. And what it is, it's a keyboard player, double bass player, me on drums with brushes, and a violin player called Ben Holder. But you know, it's going to be, we don't know what it's going to be like until we rehearse, but we've got a couple of gigs booked. There's one really lovely one we're doing in February next year. So I thought, well, if you can imagine how many times have I played Rock and Roll Over the World, Down, Paper Plane with my band, and even with Quo before that. I'm not knocking it. We enjoyed doing those songs, but I just feel that it, at my age of 76 at the moment, I'd like to do something different.
Yeah, I don't know, I get that, because it's great reliving those things and bringing it all back to life like you've been doing, haven't you, for the last, you know, well, God knows how many years, reliving the Quo years and developing something different. But to actually put that aside and express a different element of your personality and your drumming,
yeah,
I can really understand that. I mean, last time we spoke, you were discussing with me all the different drumming styles and how, you know, you have, from the very early days, had that unique style of yours. So I think that kind of works well with jazz, doesn't it?
Well, that also is interesting, because we, at the Coin Convention in Minehead on the weekend, I was signing so many autographs and pictures being taken. It was just like I was still with the band. It was quite strange, because I left in 81, 82. This is a long time. But anyway, a girl said to me, oh, I just noticed, John, you signed the autograph with your left hand, right? I said, yeah, I'm left-handed. And she's a drummer too. And she said, but you play drums right-handed, which I do. And I said, yeah, that's all it was. In my day, in my early days of watching drummers in big jazz orchestras and things, I was teaching myself to play, and I never saw a left-handed drummer. I mean, it obviously did exist then, but I never saw one. So I taught myself to play right-handed and leading with my left hand. You know, if I had a drum kit, I could show how it works, but that's another story. But yeah, I mean, John Bonham, Led Zeppelin, and Ringo Starr from the Beatles, I was told that they were left-handed, just played right-handed, you know. So it does make a difference.
Yeah, but that being part of you and the fact that you've almost done it in a mirror image, haven't you, all these years. Are you actually going to continue that? Because you were saying a bit before that you were almost like ambidextrous in a way and able to play either lead, either with your left or your right. Are you going to change your style then when you do all this jazz?
No, not really, no. It'd probably be the same set. So be using brushes probably to play quieter and stuff. But no, I mean, it'd be the same, and I'm looking forward to it because I haven't played any sort of jazz type things in years. I mean, a long time. I started off like that because that's all there was in my day, you know, in the early days. And I just love watching jazz drummers. And, you know, I was so lucky in my life to meet all the drummers I've admired and love watching them play. I met them all. Well, my biggest thing was meeting Buddy Rich, and I spent 2 hours with him.
Oh, wow.
Just me and him. Yeah, I tell you how that happened. It was because when I was with Status Quo playing drums, Premier Drums were, you know, did me a deal, and they supplied me with drums to record and tour with. And so Eddie, there's a guy, I think his name was Eddie Haynes, and he said, "Oh, John," he used to come to our gigs occasionally and make sure the drums are okay. Do I need anything else? And then, so he said, you like Buddy Rich, don't you? I said, oh, yeah. I said, I've seen him on telly many times, you know. Awesome. Anyway, he said, would you like to meet him? I said, you're kidding, aren't you? I said, of course, yeah. Anyway, cut long story short, I think Status Quo was playing in Manchester. And I think, I can't remember now, I think Buddy Rich was playing in Preston Guild Hall, probably something like that. So I was taken with one of our road crew in one of the cars and taken to meet him, walked in the back door, straight into the concert hall, and I met his roadie saying, "Oh, Buddy, your guest is here." And Buddy Rich, I've heard so many stories about him, you know, all sorts. You know, if you play the wrong note, you're in trouble. And I was like really sort of scared in a funny way of meeting him. Anyway, we got on famously, and I think the reason for it we got on well is the fact that I didn't ask him, could he show me, Buddy, how to do a paradiddle or whatever it was, you know. And I think a lot of drummers used to do that with him, and, you know, and he's probably turned around and said, why don't you just go and buy the book and teach yourself, you know, why should I show, you know.
Well, he's right, though.
Yeah, but the thing is, you know, what was incredible was the fact that he said, have a play, John, have a play of my drums. I'm like, no. And I thought, you know, I wanted the stage to open up and swallow me, you know.
Oh, my God.
But anyway, I played his drums, and he was standing there. He said, "Dinner bars sounded so good, John. Great."
Oh, wow. That's wonderful. What a wonderful accolade from somebody that you admire. And wasn't he one of these... I'm right in saying he was jazz, wasn't he? And he was a really fast, you know, quite speed, intensive kind of drummer.
Oh, he was great. I mean, you know, and he I'm not sure. I don't think he ever could read music. So I can't. I can't read a note of music. Save my life. It's all just memory. And I think he had someone, I think, in his days to play with the band. He used to just watch this drummer that could read the dots, as they say.
Mm.
And he just remembered it all. But, you know, and there was a girl turned up. That's right, a journalist. And I got some great photos of him with me, and or me with him. You know, he was lovely. And and this girl's journalist said to Buddy, she said, "Well, Mr. Rich, you know, you're the best drummer in the world. What do you think of this long-haired rock drummer, like, or something like?" And do you know what? I can still remember to this day, Cat. He said, "Well, man, there's no need for that. He's doing his job. I'm doing mine." Oh, wow.
Oh, that's lovely. Oh, and I'd say right as well, because there's room in the music industry for all styles, isn't there? And everybody. They've all got something different to bring.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know, like all the drummers that I've admired, I've met them all and spent time talking to them, and I was so pleased, and it was so lovely. And yeah, I mean, I've heard things that some people were teaching their children to play an instrument, piano, saxophone, drums, bass, or whatever. And I said to this person, I said, I think it was in my local pub, I said, "Well, yeah, go for it, you know. Get them lessons, because you never know what could turn out." I mean, I didn't know in my early days when I was, the school, teaching myself to play drums. I didn't know I was going to be in a band later on in my life, that it was going to be successful. You know, you just have to go for it and see what happens.
Well, this is what's great with life, though, isn't it? It's not written, and you can create your own future. And once you get on a path, I do believe, actually, that there is that sort of path for you. But in a way, it's good that you're able to take those dreams and make them a reality, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the reason, I mean, I'll tell you, Kat, that I think in my school days, there's a guy called Stephen Ainsworth, I think his name, was sitting in my same class. He said, "Johnny, you like aeroplanes, don't you?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Look, don't tell the rest of the class, but he said, I'm in the air cadets, and why don't you come and join as well?" And we cycled up the next weekend to the squadron air training corps. And, you know, and got the uniform, the RAF uniform, and it was great. And we put a little band together in the squadron, Wally Rogers and Johnny Bush, and we just put a little band together playing Shadows instrumentals. And two guys kept coming in saying, "Can we listen?" And we said, "Yeah, yeah." Anyway, about second or third time they came and they said, "John, would you be interested in joining the our band? Are you doing it with this band?" I said, "No." I said, "I'll come and join." And I didn't know. And that was Fosse Fosse and Al Lancaster. And they were a school together. And asked me to join their band. I mean,
amazing.
Yeah, it was incredible.
So looking back on all this, it's almost like a dream come true for any young virtuoso in, you know, playing drums, got a dream. And it all just comes true. I mean, it's just quite remarkable. So looking back on it now, does it almost seem like a dream?
Yeah, oh, yeah. I mean, it was, we passed an audition in London, I think it was, to go and play the Butlins Minehead, or Butlins anyway, to play for, I think it was something like 6 weeks and play twice a day in the Rock and Roll Ballroom, which we did. And that's where there was Francis Rossi, Alan Lancaster, a guy called Roy Lyons, who was the keyboard player at the time, and me on drums. And that's where we met in 1965. I met Rick Parfitt, who was singing with two girls in a theatre called The Highlights. And so, but then Pat, our manager at the time, said, "You just get Rick in the band." And we thought, well, it's a bit cabaret. But anyway, you know, one thing led to another. He came and joined the band, and 1968 was the first hit record, Pictures of Matchstick Men on Top of the Pops. You know, and it was great. And so all I'm saying, you don't really know what the future may bring. You know, you just don't know.
Thank you.
Hi, it's John Coghlan here. You're listening to CATtales.
And I suppose now you're at a point in your life, as you say, where you're looking for something different. And there's a new adventure to have. It doesn't really matter that you're in your 70s, does it? You know, because life is still there for the taking.
Well, I think these days, in modern times like now, is that, I mean, look at the Rolling Stones, Mick Jagger, Keith Richards, and we miss Charlie now because he's not with us anymore, but they're, you know, late 70s. I can't remember how old Keith is, but in our day, in my young days, when I was a little boy at school, I mean, in those days, if you were 40 years of age, that was considered old.
I know. It's crazy, isn't it? Just absolutely crazy. When actually, no, now, you know, 70 is the new 60, isn't it? 60 is the new 50, and so on and so forth. And there's so much to do, and people are far fitter, aren't they, now, than they probably were years ago. I think that's probably an important part of it, isn't it?
Well, I just think, you know, being a musician and playing drums, I mean, you know, it's funny, actually, Cat, it's the only bloody thing I can play. I can't play anything else. Drums and percussion is me. And someone said to me years ago, "Well, can't you play guitar then? Did you learn?" And I said, "No, well, last thing I want to do, you know, is to pick up Ritz guitar and Francis guitar and strum away. You know, I can't play guitar." And in funny ways, it felt alien to me because, drums are my thing. And drums, as you know, is what I do.
Yeah.
Never even thought about playing keyboards or guitar.
It's funny, isn't it? But then you see you're obviously naturally drawn to that. And I think it's interesting what you were saying earlier about the fact that you don't read music. And so for me, it suggests that it's almost something within you where you were connected to that drum kit with an expression of yourself rather than interpreting somebody else's music.
Yeah, I think in those days, and it was, there was jazz and I tried to play that, and then there's the blues, R&B and blues, and I played lots of records, and as we did in those days, buying records and albums and things. I used to listen to the drummers of all sorts of different bands and learn them songs. I mean, I was a fan of the Pretty Things. I was a fan of the Yardbirds, the Rolling Stones, and later on Led Zeppelin. And, you know, I mean, it's just interesting. And I thought, yeah, I really enjoy playing drums. And I still got my lovely super classic that we bought in the 60s, which was seen for the first time on Top of the Pops, Pits and Match and Men. I still got that and bought that in. It's the same drum kit that Ringo had in the Beatles, you know, same colour, Oyster Pearl, I think they called it.
Wow.
And I've still got mine, and they're great drums. I've got a Yamaha kit, and when I lived in the Isle of Man, we lived there for a long time, me and Jilly, and I had about four or five different drum kits. I mean, you know, crazy really, but yeah, good days, you know. Premier drums were great for me, and I played loads of kits, you know. But anyway, so I'm using Natal on the John Coghlan's Quo Tour, and Natal sponsored us with a nice drum kit and percussion and congas and stuff like that. Yeah, good experiences.
Oh, brilliant. Now, you mentioned earlier about Buddy Rich being a particularly important influence to you. What other, you know, artists in terms of drummers, obviously, were the ones that really influenced you the most through your career?
I liked Bobby Elliott from the Hollies and Charlie Watts from Rolling Stones, Ringo, of course, John Bonham. Met John. And funny, I'll tell you a story how I met John. I used to know Ken Jones. He was a roadie for the Kinks and in those days. And Ken said, "Oh, we're going to record for radio, the BBC." And it was a radio, a rock program, radio, you know. And they recorded it in a studio. Studio. It was a theatre in London. I think it was somewhere near Piccadilly. Anyway, so we all turn up there, A-time, and there's this character playing piano, Tim Rose, a bass player and a drummer. And he said, "God, that drummer's good. Who's that?" Anyway, they recorded their stuff for radio. Then John Bonham walked up the aisle to speak to us, and Yes, hello, my name's John Bonham. Tim Bowes is going back to America tomorrow. Here's my number. If you hear of a band that needs a drummer. Okay, John, thank you, mate. And they packed the gear away and gone. Of course, you know, you keep the number, the next thing I see is a band called Led Zeppelin and Bonzo playing for Led Zeppelin. I thought, wow, you know. And, I remember doing a Status Quo tour, and I said to Colin Johnson, his own manager at the time, I said, look, you said we need a support band. Can we, what about the Pretty Things? Because I was a fan, so I love their music. So Colin got the Pretty Things as a full time on the English tour in the UK. So anyway, right near the end of the tour, Pretty Things said, thank you, John, for mentioning us. I said, no problem. And they gave us tickets to see Led Zeppelin at Olympia in London. I think it's still there, Olympia, the gig. And, we went along with the Pretties and with us and sitting in the audience. It was awesome. And I remember Francis Rossi saying to me, that drummer's great, John. You know, oh, isn't he? Awesome. You know, the power and sound of the kit. Anyway, after that, we were all invited backstage. And it was quite funny because there was a big backstage area and there's a band playing. Led Zeppelin had a band playing, an after-show party. All had a drink and I had a quick chat to Bonzo. But, you know, great memories. And all those drummers, Brian Bennett from the Shadows, I've admired for donkey's years. I know Brian. And there's an old boys' lunch we have twice a year in London.
Terrific.
Always turns up Bruce Welch. And, you know, all the people, sometimes Noddy Holder, Don Powell, who was the drummer. So, and loads of people like that. And it was just good fun, you know, and it was so lovely to meet John, but sadly not with us anymore, you know.
No.
Yeah, I know, it's awful, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. I mean, I was going to ask you about Alan. Obviously, Alan's departed, has now passed on, bless him. You know, did that influence part of you thinking, do you know, it's time now to put Quo behind me, you know, even though obviously it's been, you know, JC's Quo, but, you know, time to do something different. Did that influence you?
I think, I said to the band, you know, we can always reform again another time. Maybe I was thinking maybe a show at Christmas or a show next year sometime. Because I remember Mick wanted to do something different. I think Rick wanted to do something different. And I think it's not that we got fed up playing Quo, it's just that I think as a musician, you get times when you want to change your set list. You know, I often wonder, Kat, how many times have I played with Quo and JCQ and other bands? How many times have I played Rock and Over the World, Down Down, Paper Plane, you know, Whatever You Want, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, it must be thousands and thousands and thousands of times I've played those songs.
Yeah, it must, and that's just it, isn't it? And you think, right, well, you know, I've done that song justice. I can't do it any differently because it is what it is. Now's time to express myself in a different way. And why not? As we said, you know, 70s isn't old these days. So do something different.
Yeah, I just think it is. I think I remember Charlie Watts had the Charlie Watts Orchestra, you know, in those days, and he just loved his jazz. And I think it was something different. And why not, you know? Why do it and just put on a good show for the punters that have paid tickets? You know, just put... you're there to entertain, and that's what we all forget sometimes and in the business, but that's what your job is. You're an entertainer, you know, and it's lovely that people want to come see you play, buy tickets, and then you find out you sold out, and it's great. You say, well, we must be doing something right.
People still want to see you. And I think this was the great thing when I read about, obviously, the fact that we had this retirement label on you. I thought people were still, you know, concerned about that because they want to still see you. So if there's a demand there, then, you know, why not do it, John?
Oh, the thing is, I don't do much. You know, I belong to the Military Vehicle Trust as a friend, and we just like the old military vehicles. I've had an old truck and that. I've had loads of different stuff. But then you do that. But then, of course, then things have been cancelled in the past, as you know, because of lockdown. And You know, you think, oh, God. And I said to the audience that when we played Portsmouth with Aldershot, I said to the audience, I thanked them so much. I said, thank you for supporting the band, supporting Status Quo, and supporting venues. I said, because in lockdown, it was a nightmare. And I said, give yourselves a round of applause. They all cheered. And some people were actually in the audience in tears because they just wanted to get out, get out and then be detained. I mean, you just can't express it. It was so wonderful. Hi, it's John Coghlan here. You're listening to CATtales.
It's a two-way relationship, isn't it, really? Because you're entertaining them and they value that so much and are so grateful. And it is a magical moment, isn't it, which brings you both together, that's unique in a live performance, which you don't get when it's recorded.
That's right, yeah. And I just think some bands, you know, in my past I've seen some bands trying to reproduce their sounds and hasn't been that good. But I think, I must say, what we did with Quo, we played everything, you know, recorded everything live and still played together, of course, like we're supposed to. Anyway, there wasn't that much overdubs. And what we tried to do was recreate that recorded sound on stage, which can be possible by not overdubbing too much, you know. Then, of course, if you're going to put extra keyboards, extra trumpets, extra whatever on. You've got to employ those people to play those parts. And I think with Quote, it's just the... I know we had keyboards and ride lines and then Andy Bound joined, but, you know, we produced what, as far as I'm concerned, we produced what was on the record.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that's the beauty of it, and that's why people have always wanted to see you play live, I think. And yeah. I think, you know, going into this new era of yours, I think the interesting thing here is that you're going to be interpreting other people's music by the sound of it.
Yeah, and also Paul Jeffries, who's the double bass player, came up with an idea. So what we could do some Status Quo stuff, if you like. I said, well, why not? We do a different version, but do it instrumentally. Maybe, I think Ben Holder, the violin, sings and vocals, but what I'm saying, it doesn't have to be exactly like the record, you know, it'd be J.C. Kieran Status Quo. So it could be another version. That's why it says reimagined. So I just thought, well, I'll give it a try, see what happens. And I think the first gig in Burford at Warwick Hall is sold out, I believe.
Wow, brilliant. And I'm not surprised. And it sounds absolutely tremendous. And I'm going to say to everybody, you've got to go and see you because you are fabulous live. It doesn't matter what you're playing. You know, you're the real deal.
Oh, thank you, Kat.
Oh, bless you. Now, you haven't got a dog, obviously, so you're not going to be walking the dog even when you do retire, which obviously isn't yet. What other things do you actually like to do, John? You said there about volunteering. What other things take up your time?
Blimey, I don't know. I like flying aeroplanes. I don't have a licence, but I have flown a bit with various friends, so... learning to do that gigs. Rick Parfitt loved doing that in his early days. He used to fly up Fairhopes in Surrey.
Yeah.
And I think Rick did actually pass the test, and I think he got a licence, but then he stopped flying because I think he just got fed up with it. But anyway, because I live...
You have to keep up your flying hours, don't you? A number of hours to do it, which, you know, quite an investment, I think.
Yeah, because the good thing is I'm very interested in the Royal Air Force, and by chance, when we moved here from the Isle of Man, we're right near RAF Bryce Norton, and I've been on the base many times and been on the simulator and learned to fly that. But, you know,
brilliant.
I just aeroplanes, and maybe that's another little thing I can do, you know.
You're still young enough to go and do something different like that. That would be terrific.
Supposed to be doing some... DJing with a little radio station called Whitney Radio in Oxfordshire.
Oh, and
yeah, and I thought, you know, go for it. And I said, look, I'd like to do a program, you know, I don't know, say maybe an hour, once a month, or once every 2 weeks, whatever. Basically playing all the music that I like, you know. Mm. The other pretty things, Led Zeppelin, Rolling Stones, Beatles, and all that, and just, you know, say what I think about those songs. And all a good view, of course, because I wouldn't obviously play Led Zeppelin if I didn't like it. But you know, and so much stuff out there of good rock bands and good rock music should be played, you know, and remembered, like the Yardbirds. We on Status Quo, we actually did support the Yardbirds and Elton Bars once years ago, and it was so good to see them playing and the Kinks and things like that. You know, and just great days. And play some Kinks stuff. And I know Mick Avery. I see Mick a few times a year, drummer who comes at the boys' lunches. But you know, just good cat. You know, just good music.
Going to be something to listen to. I wish you well with that. I think it sounds absolutely fabulous, and so does all this jazz stuff, which we've obviously got to come and see you do live. So John, I will leave you to your day. It's been a delight talking to you, and thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me.
Thank you, darling. Bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to me, Kat, and my guest today, John Coghlan. The tracks featured are Rocking All Over the World, Mystery Song, and Down Down by Status Quo, and Lockdown by John Coghlan's Quo. For more information on John Coghlan, go to johncoghlan.com. And to listen to this again and to other tales, go to cattales.co.uk.
You've been listening to Kat.